actually going to start by getting your questions, because we have 90 minutes to spend together. I wanted to be as productive as possible, so I want to try to answer things that you actually care about on these subjects. So while I introduce myself, don't listen to me, just think about things that you would like to know in this session. Hello, my name is Roy Oshrove, and you can get me on Twitter at Roy Oshrove. We have a lot of the stuff we're going to talk about today at howardofuniversity.com. I also do consulting and course on these things, up to 5 days. In C++, it's a 3-4 system, 6 days. There's a second edition of this book that came out recently, and that fixes a lot of the misconceptions that I personally have about isolation frameworks. And we're going to talk about that today as well, about the things that I used to think were good ideas of today. And I would like to hear from you if there's anything that you would like to hear in this session to make it worthwhile. Because this room is hot. So if you're going to spend time here, it might as well be worth it. Is there anything that you want to know about specifically, like a question you want to try and cover or something? And based on the topics, I think they're going to be talking based on that. Is there anything that you're interested in finding out? Want to hear more about? You don't know what you want? Yes.
You talk about auto mocking frameworks. Is there an automatic generation system?
Integration test hidden in that test that you have. Now, a lot of times this happens. happens when you have shared dependencies between the tests. Now in this case, we're going to have everything in memory. So I want to have a logging manager, but I still want a test that calls logger, even though I don't have control of the logger. Now this is very important. I want to be able to test that I can call the logger, even though the logger is contained in the logger. This is the idea of parallel development by multiple teams, very important. But I can't really do that if I needed a binary dependency on logger. So instead, I need to find a way to replace logger in something else, something that looks like it. Then if I call that something that looks like it, I'm pretty sure it calls logger when the time is right. And that's where we introduce, in this example, a new interface. And the new interface in the system allows me to replace an object with something that looks like it. And also, I change the signature of logging manager in the constructor to use an iLogger interface. Now, this idea of injecting the dependency through the constructor is called constructor injection. There are several types of injection, property injection, etc. Constructor injection is used the most. Does anybody know why? Guarantees that you have to set them. It's not optional. When you have these parameters, it's not optional. So if you, in terms of design, when I look at a constructor and I look at the list of parameters, I can see all the dependencies that I need to make the object function. So it makes things even more readable. And also, if I have properties that I need to set, I have to remember that. Okay, so what else do I do after I create the interface? I have to create something that implements the interface. And I'm not using a framework yet. You have to understand how they work. So in this case, I'll create a new class in my code called the frame logger. Notice it's not called the mock or stub, not called the shim. It's called the frame logger. I'll explain why it's called the frame and not the other things after a few minutes. But this class exists in my production code. It exists in my test code. It does not exist in my production code. The interface exists in my production code. So my production code sees the interface, but it doesn't know that there is even such a thing as a fake logger. In my test, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create an instance of fake logger, send it into a new logging manager, call this login OK, and then check that the interface method that I say write was called with the right string. Now, how do I check it? Because this class is in my test, it's fully under my control, I can change its code. So I can just override the method for write and save the value and put it in the public variables. I can assert it. In this case, I'm using the fake logger, sending it in, and I'm asserting it next time. I'm using it to verify that my test is passed. When something that looks like something else is used to verify that your test is passed, if you assert against it, it's called a mock object. So when you have a fake object, based on how you use it, it could be a mock object. Fake is anything that looks like something else. So in this case, I'm using the fake logger as a mock object in this specific test. I can have other tests where you use the same fake logger as a stub. The stub means that I override a dependency, but I don't assert against it. I'm just using it so I can test something else. So it just makes half of use. In that regard, we have usually we'll have no more than a single mock object per test. We have multiple stubs. We have multiple dependencies, but we're only testing only a single one in each test. Because each test we want to test only one thing. If you have any questions, because this is more ground just for you, just raise your hand and ask them. Just treat it as a one-off part of my help class. Let's look at an example of that. I happen to have here an example of what a class called fake logger would be. Let me show you the logging manager class here. I could choose to create two constructors, but a lot of times I'll just have a single constructor. This is what the constructor looks like. It takes an iLogger, it saves it and hold right. That's what I want to test. But in my tests, I will create a new class called fake. fake log or incoming side log as a cultic variable called text. I'm not even making it a property, because I want my fake objects to be as simple as possible. And in the write method that is part of the interface, I don't really write anything, I just save the value. Because the point of this test is that I break it against, that I don't actually use a text file or a database or anything like that, because if I did, it would be an integration test that uses the file system or databases, and I don't have control over it anymore. I have to start cleaning up things in the system, and everything becomes more complicated. So I'm just running everything in memory.
Exception from a fake class is something that's unreadable. The reader of the test.
going to put a placeholder in the fake argument to allow the test to set a flag whether to throw an exception or not, and what type of exception to throw. That will make my test more readable and more retained. And notice that when you write tests, the emphasis on readability and maintainability should be just as high, if not more, than regular code. You don't just test things. You write the test as a piece of code that has to live for 10 years and someone else has to read it. So whenever I write tests, notice, ask myself this question. Imagine that the reader of your test is a serial killer that knows where you live. Don't make them ask any unnecessary questions about the tests. Come to your house with an axe and ask you. So if you can avoid any unnecessary questions, that's a very good idea. Save web service. Probably just localize that to save method or write method on web service somewhere in order time. But it looks just like that fake logger from before. Now in this example, which one is the mock object? The web service. Why? Yes, this is the one we're checking if it was called or not. This is the one we're going to insert against. We're going to tell logger to throw an exception, invoke is logging OK, and then assert the fake web service gets some kind of message. So this one will determine if our test is fake or not. So what is fake logger? A stub. Everything that's not a mock is a stub. That's how we should think about it. They're both fake objects, but based on how you use it, it's either a mock or a stub. So it has it, it's a mock, otherwise it's a stub. That should be it. That should be all you need to know about those differences. That's where shims don't fit into that idea. But shims are a special case, and I'll talk about that in a moment. Our API and things like that. So let's look at an example. Now in this example, just below, I've created a fake logger too, just so that the demo will be clearer. But usually I'll reuse and I'll add these pieces of code to the original fake logger. So this looks almost the same, but it has this if. If the will throw is not null, then throw whatever is inside will throw. Will throw is basically an exception. That's the main difference. So that in my test, create a new fake logger and say stub log, notice the name of the variable, dot will throw new logger exception. But I can reuse it. In other tests, I can simulate different types of exceptions. I can simulate out of memory exception very, very easily, whatever I want. And just below it, I have the fake web service. And here, I just override the write method, save the method just like before, and have a public screen. So my test is creating the fake logger, telling it to throw an exception, creating a new fake web service, initializing the login manager with the stub log in the mock service. All is login OK, and assert that mock service dot message contains this string dot exception. Now, if I review someone's test and I see a stub being inserted on, like in the name of the variable, it's very easy to tell. And usually you wouldn't want to assert all the stuff. I said that usually you want to have just one mock object per test, but you could have more. So what prevents me from asserting also on the logger? Nothing technically, but why is this not such a good idea? There could be several reasons why the test is failing, so it still fails. So more difficult to figure out which one failed, but it's just a couple of lines. I can just comment on that.
For automation, we'd like to have it separate.
For automation, I can automate them, you still have to assert in a single test. It doesn't change my automation problems.
What's your name, integration?
No, it's not an integration test, but I have multiple asserts in this thing. The main problem, and it's connected to this idea that if one fails, you still don't know. lot of times, when people have these multiple asserts on different objects, different returns to the same test, it affects the test in multiple ways. First of all, the name of the test becomes very, very generic and hard to understand. Because there isn't just one multiple thing. So let's say I'm testing 2, 3, 5 things. Suddenly the name of the test is login okay, login throws exception. Works. And now you have to go and read the code of the test. And one of my goals is to have the test name so clear, I don't have to read the code for once. And when I see the test fail, I know what's going on without reading the code. Now the second problem is that if I have multiple sorts of different bond objects, if the first one fails, the other ones never execute. They don't even fail. Because when an insert fails in tests, especially in .NET and Java, it actually throws an exception. That means that any line below that exception will not get executed. So now I get to choose. I'm like a doctor who gets a patient and the patient tells me some of the symptoms. Now I have to figure out what the problem is. Do I actually start commenting out some of the lines and then figure out what happened? Or do I go, okay, I know what this what happened and I fix it. And then suddenly the line after it fails. Now did it fail because of the fix? Did it fail even before I fix it? This is called assertion roulette. The idea is that you only get a piece of the information, and actually understanding the full information will take you much longer than just separating out the tests. And it also affects the readability of the test.
Just ask a question. So, in this instance, suppose you wanted to know that the web service was called only once. Would you say that was two tests, that it's called once, and it's called the back exception? Would you do that in one test?
So multiple concerns is five about concerns in multiple options. If you're testing multiple things, the same option, like the first one, usually it's the same concern. So the question to ask yourself is, if the first one fails, do I care about the other one, or do I not even care about the other one? If I don't care about the other one, then they're connected to the same concern. Okay? Now, usually I will not test if something was called only once naturally. Unless it's to prove that there was a bug that gets called multiple times initially. Because checking how many times an object has called can be considered. It really depends on the way that you view the world, but in my view, it's considered an over-specification. I'm checking too many things internally. If it gets called 3 times but everything is still working, why do I care? Do I only care about performance? That would be integration testing anyway. But if I don't care, if it gets called 1 or 3 times, the logger gets called 5 times by 5 other components on the way, should that break really my test? The answer is no. I want my test to break as least as possible, and only for the right reasons. So I want my test not to lie to me, but I don't want it to say, you told me it's going to be called 2 times and it was called 3 times. So I'm failing, and you know that everything is still okay. And if you have a lot of tests like this, after a while you begin to just shut them off.
There are no scenarios when you call into the class and it is generally just a pass through and makes it call to the entity layer or something of that sort. So in that scenario, if you have to mock, if you have to actually unit test it, then generally it is. I mean, the only option you have is to see whether it was called once or not.
If you have pass-through objects, it really depends on the type of scenario. Excuse my amazing legs, by the way. But there, this is very important. If we want our test to be maintainable, let's say that we have multiple layers, multiple classes calling each other. This one is just above the data. This is usually the data layer. Okay. And hello camera, you can't see me, but I'm doing an amazing point here. Okay. And the data layer is the one thing that usually I wouldn't test without integration. So it doesn't make sense. The database and the data layer are connected. So even if that layer worked, it doesn't mean that this works. There's logic here. But the layers here, if I can have a call here that does everything that returns value, ways from here. I don't really care if there's a layer in the middle. If I can have everything running in memory connected to each other and it's simple and it's readable,
I don't care, I'll just use it. I don't have to prove that this one actually exists. And then that leaves me the ability to refactor the middle of the unit, right? This whole thing is called the unit of work, right? It either returns a value at the end, or it changes the state of the system, or it calls a third party, right? Something like this. But this could be considered a unit of work. It could be a single method, it could be multiple classes, it could be multiple assemblies. And as long as this is memory consistent, I don't care that there's another layer. I can run anything and everything is simple. And only if I discover something that's problematic about that test, then I will start to tear them apart and test them. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I think it was sense, yes. For example, you're in a business layer and you just make a call to the data layer to get something, and you're testing the business layer. And all it does is simply it's called to the proxy service or something.
No, but if I was in a data layer, I'll just take the data layer.
Yes, so if you pump the data, and the only thing it does is it calls into some method,
then I wouldn't test that it calls it. I should test that even the data layer gives some kind of data. The data is represented somewhere in the system.
But then that data is a page itself, isn't it? So you set it up, and you can't test against the
No, but it applies to this specific case. So if I'm testing this object right here, I'm saying I want you to prove that even this, that you're working with, that you're getting the right information from the data access layer. So if you're saying add user, and if the user exists, then throw an exception, then I'll tell this to return a fake user with the credentials I'm going to give you. And then it will test this layer. And this layer should throw an exception. But I'm not even using a mock object. I'm using this as a stub to return a fake user. That means that the logic here works. Because if I just prove that it calls a data layer, it doesn't prove anything. It doesn't mean that anything works. It has to result in some significant noticeable change. Either a return value, and an exception is an example of a return value, or that the system behaves differently. And a data layer usually is, I don't consider it a third party. I consider it something that has to do with integration testing. It has to do with integration testing. And everything else could be used as a stub to return fake data and simulate a lot of different scenarios. Okay. Other questions? Okay, so we have a mock and a stub. And so far we have this basic structure in that. Now let's look at some of the problem components. And just to remind you that we have this vocabulary on the left. Now there's a vocabulary in the book called FCU test pattern. Test spy, test level, fade, mock, stub. Very, very confusing, and I find that I don't need to use all of these. So I basically don't. I basically do this. I basically use only the things on the left. So it looks like something else is a fake, and if you insert against it, it's a mock, otherwise it's a stub. And that's usually good enough to make sure that my tests are readable and maintainable. And I haven't noticed that using these different words gives me any significance. Except usually confusing people. Okay. So far we've done really, really simple stuff with handwritten fakes. But the problems begin as soon as you get into the real world, which is sometimes you have 20 methods or 5 parameters, and you have to check much more complicated things. Like sometimes you will have to check how many times something is called. You want to simulate different things. Now we're going to have to add all those ifs and all the methods. If you do this enough in multiple projects or with the same framework, you're going to end up with your own isolation framework. And I'm using the word isolation instead of a mocking framework because I believe the word mocking is very, very overloaded. Everyone said, I'm going to mock this, I'm going to mock that, but it really, a lot of times, I'm going to stub this, I'm going to stub that. And we know that there is a difference. If everything is a mock, then I usually will assert on everything, but I don't want to assert on everything. In fact, I want to have as little mocks as possible in my tests. Mocks are important to know, but not because you have to use it everywhere, because you don't have to use it everywhere. You have to know what you're facing. Mock objects will usually create much more complicated tests, less readable. So if you don't have to use them, don't. You can use just stubs. And just because you have stubs doesn't mean you have to assert against them. But a lot of people that come from, that have some years' experience when they started with mock objects and stuff, stubs, you would usually assert a lot of things. You would assert a hell of a lot of things just to see how, just to prove that you could, actually. It would create really, really unreliable tests. Okay. So it's great for simple scenarios, but these frameworks help us when we get into the real world with more complicated things. And with an isolation framework, the idea is that the isolated unit of work from the dependencies of that unit. We can dynamically create these fake objects and then use them the way we want to. They would usually just save automatically all the arguments and we just assert after the, or by the end of the test, all the things that could have happened. And we can simulate things like flow exception, very, very easily. Now, in terms of frameworks, I'm going to talk about C sharp today. Is there anyone who doesn't do C sharp here? Okay. So in C sharp, there are a bunch of frameworks. The ones on the right are free, the ones on the left are not free or closed source. And they're divided by these two categories, constrained and unconstrained. I'm going to talk about the difference between them. We're going to start talking about the constrained first. The constrained frameworks are called this because they're basically using the same method I just showed you. Generate code at runtime that inherits from the class that you want to think. And overrides the methods of that class. So they abide by the same rules that we abide by. The method has to be public, has to be either virtual or it's in movies. If the method is private or static, we can't fake it. If the object is sealed, if we can't inherit from it, we can't fake it. If it has a private constructor, we can't fake it. It's constrained by all these things. That's why these frameworks do specific things, but the frameworks on the left do much more. The frameworks on the left are called, I call them unconstrained, because they're not using the same method. They're using what's called compiler-based. But these ideas of constrained and unconstrained will actually exist in all the languages that you know, unless it's one of those languages that's more dynamic, like Ruby or Python, where the language itself allows almost any object to be unconstrained to fit whatever you want by default, or JavaScript. But in static languages, Java, C++, C#, these things, there will always be some frameworks that can do more than other things. And usually it depends on the way that they do things. So in Java, you don't have compiler, but you have different things that can happen. So even in Java, you have those same different ideas. Now, I'm going to talk about the profiler API so that you understand just how powerful this is. I used to work at a company called PyCon. They were the first to actually create this kind of thing. I joined after it existed for several years. But I worked it for 3 years, so I know a lot about the things that work internally. I haven't worked it for 3 or 4 years, so don't worry. I'm still objective. But it's the best. I wrote the API. Here's how this works. Who knows what a profiler API is? Who heard this name? Okay. Profiler APIs are a set of unmanaged C++ COM objects that you can listen to, and they wrap the CLR, the common language. So as our code, when we compile C# code, it's compiled into IL, intermediate language. It doesn't actually become binary. And that IL, as we double-click on an executable, for example, actually gets compiled at runtime in memory by the CLR into binary. And a lot of that process, including running all the methods as hooks, as events, we can listen to these interesting events. For example, method started with a little exception. But we also get these interesting events before the IL gets turned into binary. We can get an event that gives us the IL control. Even allows us to change the IL. Now this event happens for all methods, not just the code that we wrote. All methods that we share the CRM, all the stuff that's really hard. It happens for everything, including the .NET framework itself. But it won't happen for the things that are engined or that are pre-compiled. We can do that process. But it will happen for everything else. If you hook up into this, you will be able to administer your permissions to do this. But to hook up to this, all you need is a couple of environment variables in the process that's running the CLR. And that's all. They will be turned on by default. That's why the frameworks that use Profilo-based require you to install an add-in inside Visual Studio. A lot of what the add-in does is set those environment variables so that the tests running the process reveals to environment variables. And then they can listen in on the things works. Now the Profilo APIs are usually mostly unlocking. It's very, very hard to work with it. And it's just a pain to work with it. And that's one of the reasons that the companies that do this, JustPop, Python, etc. That's why these two things cost money. It's really difficult to develop these things. I wish Microsoft had made things that we didn't really understand or about yet. But most of the time, it's not documented. You have to scrap your ways to find how to do something. And in each new version of .NET, you have to rethink that document for you. Change it. So it's a moving target. But let's say that we got all the way there and we're listening to this event, we get the IL. Now we get the IL for all the methods that are going to be executed. So for each method, I'm going to add a header and a postfix, or a prefix and a postfix. And your prefix, I'll ask, is this method supposed to be fake? And in the postfix, I'll ask, is this method supposed to be an exception? And these hook up to things that I can control from managed. That's where the API can be. Then you can say, you know what? This method should throw an exception, and that method should be hit. But it's not really inheriting from anything. You're basically setting flags in memory. Now, this happens for all methods. It could be private methods, static constructors, anything in the base class, derived class, whatever. Any method at any level you can think of will actually get executed in that form. So imagine we have all methods covered. Now we just get to choose which ones to make different things. So it's really aspect-oriented programming at its core. The idea is that you go through everything and you instrument it. And that's where the profiler APIs are originally used. All the profiling tools, they tell you performance and memory and all that stuff, they're using the same hooks. We're just abusing those hooks and telling those methods to behave differently. So it's really a takeoff on existing technology and just putting a different idea. Because of that, we can fake anything we want. Private methods, static methods, anything like that. There are three frameworks in .NET Core that do this today. Python Isolator is the oldest one. It exists for more than 7 or 8 years. And it also costs the most, I think it's $700 or $800 for a seat. Just one costs about half of that. It's also relatively new, just a couple or 3 years old, maybe four. But so it has a bit less features, and the API is, I find the API a bit less, just my current thing. And MOLD, or it used to be called MOLD, today it's called Microsoft Fates, is a technology built by Microsoft. Funnily enough, it was built by Microsoft after a visit of the type mod to the Microsoft offices in Redmond. Showing this interesting technology. In MOLDs, we have the idea of stubs and shims. Notice that stubs are constraining and shims are usually profiling. And I'll explain a bit more about that, but the idea is that MS Fakes uses the idea of shims to tell you that these are things that you would use profiler API to fake, and some things you could just use inherit and override. These two things. Now, in terms of unconfined frameworks, we have the oldest ones are NUnitMods and RhinoMods, which I don't recommend using anymore. How many of you have used RhinoMods before? Okay, stop. Stop. Not because it's bad, I mean, it's not amazing anymore, but the person who wrote RhinoMods, or an Amy, got married. He has a life now, and he doesn't support it. AnyNitMox was never designed to be used in production. AnyNitMox is a material framework developed to test AnyNit itself. It's also very, very basic and very old. We're going to use it to do a little archaeology to see where these frameworks started with C sharp, just the evolution of their APIs. Now MOQ, M-O-Q, used to be the, or still is, today's the front runner. It's the one that most people use. I'm going to explain why you shouldn't use it as well. Today, I explain how I recommend your fake in your instance in terms of the frameworks to use. And I'll explain why. I have a full slide about that. Question before we dive into the APIs?
Throw this method.
but only on this input. In mock service, they say expect some overwrite with cloud exception. And here again, I create body manager and I cast this, cast that. A lot, actually, changed a lot about how the community thought about APIs. It was the first framework to ever use delegates and lambdas to avoid writing method-related strings. So I'm pretty sure it was the first user that would want, but I think it was run mocks. And the idea is that if I was to say, give me a mock object, I would say mock repository.generate mock, then create a login manager. Notice this is already strongly typed. So it's using generics. So I don't have to cast this. But here I say a circle is called, and then I give it a lambda expression. That lambda expression basically can be read in parse. And depending on the framework, you see a lot of lambda expressions. Some frameworks can parse the lambda expression tree and see what is supposed to happen. Some frameworks will actually execute it in memory and see what happens. And it really depends on which framework you're using and in which version. Some of them change their version. In this specific version, I'm not sure which one actually has. But what's important is that the API no longer uses a string. So that if I name the method differently, I can refactor it even from here, and it will change. Not for a test. Now, another thing that happens here is that notice that I don't have a verify. I say mock log of a service call. Now, RhinoMox chose to use an API that has an extension method. I can basically say one dot service call, even though it's not really a mock object. Because this is an extension method that can be called all objects. Now, that's one design decision. The idea was that he didn't want to have a controller create a mock of something and then verify against it. He wanted to just be able to arrange at the surface, so it's more readable. And for that, gave up some, gave a bit more confusing API for units. This is the same test for two dependencies, stub logger, generate stub. Notice that there's a generate stub and a stub. A stub that gets generated, RhinoMox can never actually throw an exception, even if you assert against it, because it's a stub. It's not supposed to throw an exception. So it will not tell you anything. It will always work. Stub log, I tell you to expect the method write and throw this exception. So another change is that we have this chaining in the API. And then I have a generate mock, and that's basically it. After that, I just go to the mock service, questions so far?
RhinoMox has a thing on there called generate strict mock as well.
Yes.
Definitely.
I don't actually cover that. But strict mocks are something that are actually very, very important to know about, and I'm happy to do this. Basically, there are two types of mock objects in the world, strict mocks and non-strict. By default, the frameworks we've seen are non-strict. And that means that if you call a method on them that wasn't expected, nothing will happen. A strict mock will apply whenever it gets the call on a method. Now, by definition, the method that strict mocks require you to do over specification. Because you tell them exactly how much method that you can call, all the method will get called. That means that if tomorrow you add an interaction, even if it has nothing to do with the test, it doesn't actually hurt the functionality, you might have a bunch of tests that yell at you because they're sprints. By default, I call the non-strict ones just independent ones. Because they're like, dude, whatever. Yeah. You can call them 100 times, but you can verify,
hey, is one of those 100 times looking like this? Because if that's, yeah, that's cool, dude.
Yeah, that happened.
Yeah, there are like 100 calls, but this one happened.
Yeah, I think
the strict monk is like, only this is allowed. So it's really the inverse. So it will break much more often, and it will make you cry. It will make you delete tests. We want our tests to actually live for a long time. So non-strict monks are a much better way, as far as I see it, to make our tests live longer and not go for unnecessary things.
So it's more about an over-specification if you use the strict monks. Maybe service as another method which you can delete the user. So it's not just be that you test that the object is doing what it should do, but also that it's not doing what it should not do.
Yes. So testing that it's not doing what it shouldn't do is something that you that sounds okay in one test, and now you have 200 of these. And now the reality is changing. You need to add that something. Something is okay. You have to go and change one of the tests. And now life becomes horrible. These tests were not such a great idea. Now, the main thinking, when monks actually got created, they started as strict. In the Java world, the first one that came up with the idea of JMonk, and they actually started here in London. Steve Freeman was one of the people who came up with this. The way that they thought about this, and they still think about it today, is that they use these strict behaviors to design a protocol of interaction. So by telling it what's supposed to happen, you can look at the test and understand the interaction between objects. And it's a way of design. Now, that way of design still exists today. I don't agree with it. I think that it creates that bad way of design of making the test tell you all the protocol that's supposed to happen against them causes very, very fragile tests. So it's a way of thinking about it. Some people like it, some people don't like it. And the way I see it, it's unproductive. But it really is a difference in opinion. So some people will not agree with me on this.
Yeah, but how would you design a test to cover the other part?
How would I design a test to cover what doesn't happen?
Yeah.
I wouldn't.
So you just wouldn't expect that it doesn't happen?
Well, I don't know what I don't know. So usually what happens is that if I discover a bug, then I'll go ahead and make a test for that bug. That's real life. And how do you know you're done with tests? How do you know you have all the tests you can do? You don't. You just feel confident about the code at some point. You see that it covers everything that you thought it should cover. That's basically it. And then one day comes in, probably a day later, realize you forgot something, and then you say, okay, that's a bug. Let's write a failing test that proves that the bug actually happened. Fix it, now the test should pass. Everything's good. Maybe it makes me think about five more tests. But I usually let the thing that I don't care about happen, because they could be completely different concerns. I don't want the object for a test over time. Other questions? Just to prove that the coverage goes up and up and up.
that's not what we want. What we want is that we have good tests of hypercoverage. So if you want to test the code coverage, that's okay. Do test reviews. Just like code reviews, you sit next to the person and you look at the quality of the test. And if the quality of the test is good, then hypercoverage makes me happy. Okay? Okay, let's look at MOQ or mock. And mock was also a leader in its field because I think it was the first one that actually came up with the arrange act assert as a design API. And mock was the first one to just say we shouldn't use record replay. RhinoMox, you saw the new API, but the old API for RhinoMox was record replay. Used to say do this and then replay and then it will do something. And only after mock came out did RhinoMox actually change its API. So RhinoMox was the first one to actually say we should be able to do X, Y, Z, simple statements just like writing a simple test. PyCon, for example, even though it existed for a long time, started to do that as well. And the reason that record replay stuff was the first one is because first framework to report from Java from JMOC, which used before the play. So JMOC and EasyMOC are a lot of these frameworks. Now, here we have a completely different design. We have a controller and verifications. So instead of having extension methods, we create a mock of iLocker. Notice that it's called mock. There is no stub of iLocker. And this is actually not a fake object. This is actually a controller for a fake object. So if you want the actual object, you say mock log.object. And then you call this login OK, and then you verify the log.write is called. And here we see something we haven't seen before, although it does exist in RhinoMox, but I chose to show it now. And this is called magic argument. And up until now, what you've seen is hard-coded values that are being expected on the parameters. But here, we have it, and it is part of MOQ. So it is a string or is something, and you can say it is any string, or for each argument you can use an it or an imagine. And basically it means that you can verify each argument's value. You can have very complicated things, including lambda expressions. It is a string where the string contains the letter a. So again, we have a stub log, although it's still called the mock of iLogger. Notice how confusing I think that is. Notice how I think it's confusing. Stub log dot setup. Setup used to be called expect, but change the name to setup to get more readable. Write with any string, throw up an exception. And I like this this thinking where you just throw an exception no matter what happened. Don't throw an exception only in a specific string, but throw an exception. For the duration of this test, you will throw an exception. And that's a good behavior to have. Because usually the test is small enough that it's only going to be called, and that you're only going to be called once. And you should throw an exception for that. So it's only something I really like to do in test, because it makes my test a bit more future-proof. Just like S contains. S contains, string contains, those games that in the middle of the string, it has to look like this, but everything else can change constantly. So I like to keep a lot of placeholders where things can change as long as it doesn't hurt my test. Because then I don't have to go and change them when things actually change. MOQ was also the first to use the idea that you can also fit protected methods. Protected methods are basically virtual methods on existing objects. So if I have login manager with a virtual method, like write to log here, and I extracted this virtual method so that instead of calling like a static method or a future object, then I just call write to log on a virtual method. And then I override this virtual method. I create a mock of login manager with virtual method. And I say lm.protected. Special namespace in the MOQ that you have to import to get it. And then you say setup, and now you have to have a string again because it's a protection method, you don't have access to it. But
but you can also override protected virtual methods this way. Because it's basically just generating an override, just like this. If we want to, we can set this up, and then we use this query word called verifiable. Verifiable is something we have to use here, and then at the end say ln.verify. So when we get into the protected realm, we have to use this to get before the play model, which kind of sucks. So if you want to have virtual methods and you want to use them in your tests and override them, it's better to just actually make them public. Well, questions? Okay. Moving right along. Let's talk about the rest of the substitute is one of those new ones that I like. What I like about it is that it doesn't contain the word mock or stub at all. It just says, give me a substitute for something. Give me a substitute for iLogger that's been used, and then fake.receive, right, with arg, and here it's another version of the matcher, arg.isString, or s.contains.log. So it's starting to look kind of repetitive now, right? See is that a framework is just a tool. You choose based on the APIs what you like. Here's the same, but what's cool about this, actually, is that it's one of the first frameworks to implement this. I think it's the second after Python to implement recursive fakes. Recursive fakes are a wonderful, wonderful thing. The idea is that if a person, if an object has a virtual method or an interface method, and that method returns another object, that object can be faked as well, it will be faked by default. You won't have to write a line of code to fake what it returns, and to fake what the fake returns, etc. So in this simple test, I can say, if I can fake a person, that person's manager dot manager, will never be null. It will always be a fake person. So in this case, manager is just a virtual person object. That idea of a recursive fakes helps me a lot to make my test even more maintainable over the long term. Because that means that I create a fake person and I don't care about all the objects it returns unless I do. And that means that for anything that ever gets used, if something in my production code during my test starts using one of those objects, it will get a fake object, it will not get a null. And my test will not break, it will just get something. And unless I need to make it with specific values, I don't care about it. So it gives me a very broad brush to create a fake object and return a lot of fake objects by default in a single line of code. So recursive fake is something that you definitely do for. Now, this is where it gets a bit ugly. In substitute, if you want to make something for an exception, you have to say when logger.write with an argument, then do. Do basically gives you a delegate, do whatever you want. So here I just say it's an exception. So I don't think it's as readable. Here's what the ETF does. This is the same person as the fake. Create a fake of iLogger. Notice that here the word fake is the master word. There is no stub or mock. Everything starts with the letter A. There's a single point of entry. Everything starts with A. So A, fake iLogger, new login manager with a mock logger, A dot call to mock logger, right? With A string as a command, dot custom happen. Now, what happens when we have these logs? So I want to make the logger throw an exception. So A call to fake log.write list. New generation of frameworks like Python, Take It Easy, etc.
these things are much better. They're much more targeted at usability and not just ability. And questions about constraint framework so far? Yeah?
So I'm still confused. Difference between the fake and stop?
The difference between a fake and a stop.
In one sense,
the difference is different from the conventional mock and stop.
Well,
even though it's fake, but it's getting used as a stop. So first of all, I'm going to answer this question. What's the difference between a fake and a stub? Actually, does anyone here? No? I don't answer.
Is it a stub?
A stub is a fake. What's the difference? So it is not. If it looks like something else, it's a fake. If you assert against it, it's a mock. Otherwise, it's a stub. So a fake is basically this a category of objects that looks like other objects. So I can have a fake in my test, and I don't know what it is until I see how it's being used. That fake is either a mock or a stub. Sorry?
It's a base class.
It's like a base class for mock, basically. But again, I don't use the word mocking exactly because I can have a lot of stuff as well. Here, why do I use the word fake? Because the API it just felt natural. When I think about it, it's just a fake, etc., and then I assert it. And you know what? The naming tells me it's a mock object. And so when I remember it, I use the word mock, and when I don't, I don't. And then maybe I'll fix it. Maybe I don't. If it's readable, I'm okay with it. But I usually try. So it's important not to be dogmatic. If it works for you, it works. If it works for your team, change it. If it doesn't work. Yes, that's a good catch. Other questions? When do I prefer end substitute over fake easy? At the beginning, I preferred end substitute because the implementation was much better. And then fake and easy is a better implementation today. If end substitute were to change that, how they throw exceptions. And of course, they said, well, it's an open source, just agree with you, give us a pull request to fix it. Should do that. Anything else? Yeah.
Is it useful on one framework project? When you use few.
One framework change
project one or another.
Yeah. I usually will try to use one. But if it's an old one and it's an old project, just because we're using one doesn't mean we should move to a better one. So I will use logic where we have at least two. The old one and the newer ones. Yeah. And then when we work on an old test, we would usually replace the fakes with the new framework. So there has to be growth, there has to be change. So I usually will try, if it's a new project, we'll just have one and decide on it. But if it's an old project and there are much better options today, we should change it. And change it very incrementally. For the new test, we'll use the new framework. Other questions? Let's see. Okay. Now, one of the things that we can do, let's talk about isolator, this is the stuff that it can do as an example of what the OptimizeStrength frameworks can do. In this case, I'm going to look at this class, Login Manager with Statics. Now, Login Manager with Statics, actually called the static log. And the static method is something that we cannot use a constraint framework. That is, there is no interface, there is no virtual memory, there's nothing we can override. So instead, if we can actually refactor things, and I cover a lot of that stuff, like how do you refactor if you don't have one of those frameworks? What do you do? And I have a whole workshop on that tomorrow. But all the refactors. Today we're going to assume we have those frameworks. And here's an example of what I would do with isolator. Now with isolator, there are several differences. First of all, you see that we have a new attribute that's called isolator. You put it per test or at the part of the test class. Isolator is important because it's a method, it basically allows to clean up these expectations or behaviors for the objects that we can call the rest. So if we're using statics, for example, then probably then we have to clean up. So we can either say isolate.cleanup or we can just use that attribute. Now when we use isolate, remember we have to have those environment variables. So in Visual Studio I have a plugin. But if I was running it in a build server with a command line, then it has a command line and batch files to enable the process to run on those environment variables. So it should work for Kubernetes delivery just as well. Now, if I wanted to, I could just say isolate.fake. In the isolator, everything starts with isolate. Fake static methods of this type, static model. By default, what this does, it will fake all of them. I don't have to use this. But usually I would use it because I want a broad brush to fake things with. Because if I don't care about one of the static methods, I usually don't care about the others as well. So if one of them gets called, by default it wouldn't do anything, that's okay with me. But if I just want to fake one of the methods, I might just do this. Isolate.redCall, in here, I'll just call the static log without redCall. So I can just call static methods like this, and they will be faked. Then again, it was the isolate verify, which called with any argument, static log about right. Now, one thing you'll notice is there are no matchers here. By default, isolator has chosen the design decision where parameters are not actually considered until you tell it to consider them. And one of the things we saw is that by default, usually you don't care about the parameters when you fake those. So you can set in whatever you want and not do anything. So static logger write do anything. Like if it's in a null, it was considered as could be any object. If I wanted to use specific objects, then I can say write with string dot with exact arguments. And that way it will actually use the values that we set in and care about. But by default, isolator doesn't care. All the other frameworks do. All we have to say which is simpler. So here I create a new login manager, I call it login OK, and the method will actually can be verified and will not do anything because here I said ignore call. But I can also make it throw an exception, etc. Here, like how I would do it here. Again, these two things at the top are not necessary, but they're making your test much more maintainable. Fake static method of static logger and static web service. But here I want to say, other than all the other methods, just when write gets called, it will throw new logger exception. Then I say log manager. Then I might say isolate was called with any argument or with exact arguments. Static web service dot write. And if I wanted to have specific matchers, I could actually put that in lambda expressions. But I believe that one of the mistakes we made in the design of the API of isolator is that when you want to verify specific values of some parameters, that API is not very useful. I still don't remember it myself how to do it. So you're not going to see an example of that here. But it's possible. But it's not as useful as it should be like the other thing. Because this is using profiler, this code will actually just work. Static logger will not actually do anything to verify this call. Questions about this? Is it slow? It's slower than unconstrained frameworks because it basically changes the method at runtime. So it is slower. Usually, it's not as noticeable. If you have thousands and thousands of tests, it could take probably double the amount of time for tests. Okay. So yes, half a second, we'll take a second. Yeah.
My misunderstanding that was that test of the actually testing for the exception being thrown.
No. Because if you look at the name of the test, the exception being thrown is this scenario, so on average condition. What I should be testing is the thing at the end calls that works. This is where the naming convention really kicks in. Because you can get lost in these tests. It's really, really confusing when you just start out. And you find
find yourself looking at this and going, oh, what is the thing that you're then I teach my students to have names that can act like a map. I say, okay, what should we be asserting against? Okay, that thing. Okay, that makes sense. Then why are we throwing? Oh, that's why we're throwing. What is the thing we're supposed to invoke? That thing. Other questions? Okay, let's look at some more cool stuff. We're just getting started. Here, for example, I have the idea of verifying in a very backward way. I can actually get the comments and the parameters. I can say when someone calls static to web server on time, do instead, and then you get a lambda expression, you can get a content, the content and the parameters. And you can actually save them, text written, and then assert on the text written. If you wanted to verify that desktop, that's it. That's a relatively clean way to do it in isolator, not as perfect as I would like. But that's just the beginning. Let's talk about the future. So now let's say we don't have just statics. Now we have new objects. And if you're working with legacy code, a lot of times you'll see this, is that objects get created at runtime in production code. And they actually, you have no way to fake them. They're not even static. So here I want to test, for example, that a new web service gets created, or that it gets loaded a message, or that new relogger, I want to fake it. And your tools like Isolator is actually possible. Here's how you do these same tests, assuming that logger gets created at runtime. So I would create a fake dot instance of relogger. And here you can create a fake instance of anything, even if it has a private constructor, etc. Even if it's sealed. And then I will say isolate.swap all the instances, or maybe just the next instance if I wanted to, of relogger with the fake one. So for example, if I have a singleton of relogger somewhere, like relogger.instance, it would also be replaced after this line. Now when I say swap, what it actually means is redirects the calls. It's not like those objects get really replaced, but all calls to the original objects get redirected to the fake instance, to the fake logger. Now, if I have 100 objects that get created, they will all actually get redirected to that same single fake logger, and I can verify all of them. And then I would say, I should verify what's called fake logger.write. That fake logger will actually contain all the calls to the future loggers or to the single or anything like that. It'll just be redirected. And this is why this stuff works really nicely on legacy code, which was not designed to be tested. Because it just makes things a lot, lot easier. Have the isolated attribute, then at the end of the test, this will be reset. But if you didn't have the isolated, you could influence the test without the other questions? Now, in terms of Microsoft fakes, we were talking about shims and stubs. In Microsoft fakes, this idea of profiler-based exists, but also the idea of inheriting and using basically overriding. So in Microsoft fakes, the things that inherit, or you basically generate an assembly of things that inherit from objects, just like we did to inherit from iLogger, these are called stubs. And then you have things that you cannot inherit from, like date, time, etc. And those would be called shims. And they're both in the same product, mixing very, very confusing. And I highly recommend that you don't use Microsoft fakes. Even though it's free, it actually costs a lot of money. Because the maintenance and the readability of the test is going to suffer a lot. In terms of the design of the API, this product, in terms of how this product works, in terms of the design of the API, this product actually causes a lot of problems. Here's an example of a stub. Let's say that I wanted to stub this method. Get on those surprise and return fee to get share price. So basically, this is an example of a test of using. You would have to basically generate an assembly that of all these types can inherit. Stop analysis dot fakes dot stub. And then you have the word stub and then the type that you actually want to fake. Stub I stop feed. And then you would tell it what to return using basically a setting up a property. A lambda expression. So you basically can actually say setting up lambda expressions, and that's basically it. You would say that, but the problem is that this is very, very unmediated. Is that if you change the APIs, you have to regenerate the assembly over and over again. And if you have a lot of changes, you generate the assembly over and over again, and suddenly your tests have to recompile, and you have to go and fix all your tests. And that causes a lot of pain. There is no good solution for that. So there are a lot of people who try to use it, and it just basically stops you from doing testing instead of helping you. Here's an example of a shim. If I wanted to fake this datetime.now.here, and this is important, I didn't mention this, but the compiler-based frameworks, they could fake all the .NET frameworks, like the string, if they wanted to. But it would be very, very performance problematic in terms of performance. The string is used everywhere. So only some of the .NET framework itself is faked by default, allowed to be faked by isolated just mock. But Microsoft Fakes is the only one that can fake most of it. Because basically they have the best access to the source code data. But you could fake big time now with isolator and just mock. Again, you generate an assembly that will allow you to do this. When you're using the shims, you have to do a using shim context.create, because that tells them basically to start using the profiler related stuff. And then you can use system states shim datetime. So everything starts with a shim datetime.now.get, because this is a property that has only a get. And for each signature of that property, you would actually get generated a new signature, a new method. And for now get, you give it a lambda expression and tell it what to return. Okay? One thing that is also missing is a verification rule. It has no verification rule. It's only a faking API. There's no way to verify that something was called. You could just basically override and give it a lambda expression that verifies things. But then again, it makes things much more difficult to get that for your problem. So what happens when you have multiple calls or a lot of methods that you need to verify and things like that? And it's also strict. It's by default, it doesn't know what to return. It doesn't have a recursive face or anything like that. By default, it doesn't know what to return. So you have to tell it everything that it has to return. Otherwise, things will break. So if you have 20 methods, you're going to have to do 20 lambda expressions. Questions? Yeah, it's the Internet Explorer of isolation nodes. Okay, now, one specific note about about time. You could fake datetime and you could use, create an interface for I time provider in your code that you could fake. But if you have code that uses time, one of the things that I like to do is to actually like to create a class in my production code. It's called system time. And not actually use any kind of framework to fake time. Because I find that time is so used in so many different places that actually makes the test very, very hard to read and very hard to write. You have to inject time all the time. So I'll just create a system time that by default returns date time now. Here. But if I tell it to return a fake time, it will return that fake time. Now, the difference is that I then have to go to all the developers in my project and ask them to use this. It's very easy, it's basically a find and replace. Everywhere you use datetime, you use system datetime. If you do code reviews, you can even do an automated tool to make sure that nobody uses datetime directly. If everybody uses system time, you can fake time in your projects very, very easily. test, you would set the daytime, and at the end of the test, or even in a teardown, you would say daytime.reset. Values of a good isolation framework. We've seen some of them, and I just want to make it clear. When I look at the framework, here are the things that I look for. I really like the idea that the framework has a single point of entry if you're new, to this whole idea. It has to be easy to implement with the API, and it has to allow you to, it doesn't have to, it's great if it allows you, it does to tell you what's allowed, what's not allowed. Frameworks that are future-proof allow will give you recursive fates, for example. Be non-strict. So if a framework is strict, it's going to really cause a lot of problems. Some frameworks actually even allow debuggability. So type of isolator, for example. Imagine that if you're using a framework, you tell a fake to return something the first time and then a different something the second time, etc. You can do that with a framework, so you can show this. But you can say return this, then that, then X, then Y, then Z. But if you debug, you put that value of that thing in a watch in a debugger, it will return X, it will actually treat it as if you call it, and then you basically affect the test by debugging it. Because your debugger actually called the method as well, instead of your production code. So debugging these things can be problematic. So frameworks like Isolator actually know when they're in the debugger and will remember, they should still return the same value. So they don't break under debugging. And that's very important. That's the type of usability that I'm talking about. So I have this nice chart about the things and about how I think about these frameworks and why I came to them. And the orange ones are the ISO provider base. And what you'll see is that green means it's okay. So AW to take it easy. Support most, if not all, of the things that I like about frameworks. And the other ones either don't support all of them or some of them. And there's one clear winner in that part. And also, in that regard, the mock is helpful unless it has bad error messages. And I forgot right here the idea that the API itself doesn't actually have the word mock, but it's quite good. Anybody still have any questions in the last couple of minutes?
How much space does not work with that? How much space, right?
MSTS, Microsoft Fakes, does not work with any of it?
Yeah, I thought that was dead, but.
No, it used to, and it was more, so it only worked with MSTS. If I'm not mistaken, it should work with anybody as long as you have a shift project in. But I haven't actually tried it, so I don't know, I'm not sure.
And therefore, time mocking does work, but it also work with any of the...
Yes. So the other frameworks would work with any of the frameworks. They don't need MMS test. That's the Internet Explorer test release, as far as we're concerned. By the way, there is a reason that I tried to use MS test release, is because it's really unmaintained. There are bugs in MS test that exist for 5 years now that have not been fixed. And it's missing really, really simple and important features. For example, NUnit has had it for a while, the idea of checking exceptions on specific lines. So in MS test, and in NUnit used to have only an attribute that says expected exception. But now, it's very, very simple with NUnit or xunit.net. To say that a specific line is supposed to draw an exception and not use an attribute, that's a much better way. That doesn't exist in MS test. Another feature that is different is that NUnit and XUnit.net allow what's called data-driven tests, or not data, but test cases. They can do multiple attributes on the test itself, give it multiple inputs into the test. In XUnit, that's called tiering. In MS test, there is a thing called data-driven tests, but the data has to be taken from Excel or anything that basically has like a connection to Excel and access, stuff like that. You
can't really put the data inside the test file, like an attribute inside it. It makes things very, very complicated. It turns a test, a simple test, into almost an integration test. So now you have to deploy files with your test and things like that. Complicates the hell out of things. So it's good if you have a million rows, but if you just want to test something with 5 different values, or 50, or 15, it doesn't make sense to do that. It's just overkill. So MS test, I say that it's really good for you. Testing, but it's not really good for unit testing. So if you're a tester, MS testing does make sense. It has a lot of nice qualities. But if you're doing unit testing in TDD, it's not the best tool for the job. N unit and X unit are much better. Other questions?
Should we give an example of an integration test, like you said there's other dependencies you need to take into account. You would be writing this as well.
Example of an integration test?
Yeah.
Like
if you say you have a database dependency,
yeah.
would you be actually usually connecting to the database and get
yeah.
How does that happen?
So, integration test, this is the perfect case for an integration test. When I'm testing a data layer, I'll never test it without a database. So a data layer is the one thing I'll never test as a unit test. Because if I test a data layer, like if I fake the database and I check the SQL that's coming up, it doesn't mean anything. If I check the SQL being sent in or being retrieved the data, if I check that the SQL being sent is correct, it doesn't mean that the application will actually work. Because the database also contains logic. It contains stored procedures. The schema is an example of logic as well. These two are actually part of the same resource. So these are perfect for basically writing a test that uses the data access layer and uses the database as well. So it needs configuration. And it will run slower, and you put it in a separate project, and you know that that project takes only integration tests, and that this project only takes unit tests. That gives you the courage to just run that project as quickly as possible, not worrying, knowing that it's always going to be a consistent result. Okay.
Separate test to test that it returns true, false, range.
but I also want to add new functionality. This time it's probably for testing or development or anything like that. I want to test that it calls a separate object that's written maybe by a different team, called logger. Now the problem with logger is that it's not done yet. I mean, I have the API for it, but if I actually use it, it might actually break. It will throw an exception, or it will work very, very slowly. It's unreliable and I don't have control over it. And when you don't have control over something, we call that a dependency. So the dependency is anything that you don't have control over, you'd like to write a unit test. Now, in our definition of a unit test, or an integration test, unit tests are something that, basically an automated test that has control over all the objects inside it. You run automatically and it has a consistent result. But if you run the test a million times, you always get the same result if you change the code. On the contrary, the integration tests will usually involve dependencies that you don't have control over, run very, very slow, and you will not always get consistent results. If you ever run tests, and every third time you get a false positive, that's an example of that you probably have an integration test hidden in that test that you have. Now, a lot of times this happens when you have shared dependencies between the tests. Now, in this case, we're going to have everything in memory. So I want to have a logging manager, but I still want a test that calls logger, even though I don't have control of the logger. Now, this is very important. I want to be able to test that I can call the logger, even though the logger is contained in the logger. This is the idea of parallel development by multiple teams, is very important. But I can't really do that if I needed a binary dependency on the logger. So instead, I need to find a way to replace logger in something else, something that looks like it. Then if I call that something that looks like it, I'm pretty sure it calls logger. So in this case, I'm using the fake logger as a log object in this specific test. I can have logger tests. If I use the same fake logger, it's a stub. The stub means that I override a dependency, but I don't assert against it. So I'm just using it so I can test something else. So it just makes happy use. In that regard, we have, usually we'll have no more than a single log object per test. We have multiple stubs. We have multiple dependencies, but we're only testing all the single log each test. Test, we want to test only one. If you have any questions, because this is more about just for you, just raise your hand and ask them. Just treat it as a one-off in my top class. Questions? Okay, let's look at an example of that. I happen to have here an example of what a class called fake logger would be. Let me show you the logging manager class here. I could choose to create two constructors, but a lot of times I'll just have a single constructor. This is what the constructor looks like. It takes an ilogger, it saves it to the variable, and holds right. That's what I want to test. But in my tests, I will create a new class called fake logger. Fake logger implements iLogger as a public variable called text. I'm not even making it a property, because I want my fake objects to be as simple as possible. And in the write method that is part of the interface, I don't really write anything, I just save the value. Because the point of this test is that I break the dependency, that I don't actually use a text file or a database or anything like that, because if I did, it would be an integration test. File system or databases, and I don't have control of it anymore. I have to start cleaning up things in the system, and everything becomes more complicated. So I'm just running everything in memory. Things that could happen as a result of a test. We either get a value back, when we change the state of the system, or we call a third party. Calling a third party is calling something we don't control. Only in the third case would we use markup things. In the other two cases, we could just use objects in memory and then check that the behavior of the system is there. For example, if I were to add a user and then log in with that user, logging would succeed. So it would actually change its behavior. But before I added the user, it would fail. But I wouldn't have to check any mock object to test that. But here, the word calls tells me that there is a notification that's supposed to happen between two objects. So calls tells me that there's probably a mock object in there. So I create the fake logger. Notice I don't create an iLogger. So I create a fake logger because I need access to that public property, variable that I have. I create the login manager. It's not login manager with mock, because it's for them. But the variable name is named mock-log. In other tests, I might use stub-log. I add a mock-logger here. I add a user, because I want to log in. Then I insert, using string insert, which is part of any unit, that the mock-log text contains a specific string. And in terms of maintainability over time, it's better to assert a string to contain something versus are equal to something. Because strings are a form of user interface. You could have an extra space tomorrow, or an extra tab, or more things in the beginning or the ending. But if you only care about specific content, contain is a much better future-proof way. So the test will be great for silly changes. Questions about this? This was the simplest mock object example. Let's talk about something a bit more complicated. Now in this example, we have two dependencies. The requirement, always these things step on requirements. The requirement is, when I call this login OK, and the logger that I'm calling automatically, if the logger throws an exception of some sort, like if the logger doesn't work, the login manager is responsible to catch that exception and notify a web service that something's wrong with the logging system. Now, usually, the logger would be responsible for something like that, but for demo purposes, I put that responsibility in the login manager. So now the requirement is the login manager doesn't just call the logger, but it calls it and it catches any exceptions and forwards a special message to the web service. So we're actually going to start by getting your questions, because we have 90 minutes to spend together. I want it to be as productive as possible, so I want to try to answer things that you actually care about. Subjects. So while I introduce myself, don't listen to me, just think about things you would like to know in this session. Hello, my name is Roy Oshrove, and you can get me on Twitter at Roy Oshrove. We have a lot of the stuff we're going to talk about today at ourunitesting.com. I also do consulting and courses on these things, up to 5 days. In C++ is 3 courses, maybe 6 days. The second edition of this book that came out recently, and that fixes a lot of the misconceptions that I personally have about isolation frameworks. And we're going to talk about that today as well, about the things that I used to think were good ideas and today are just frameworks. And I would like to hear from you if there's anything that you would like to hear in this session to make it worthwhile, because this room is hot. So, going to spend time here, might as well be worth it. Is there anything that you want to know about specifically, like a question you want to try and cover or something, and based on the topics I think they're going to be talking based on that? Is there anything that you're interested in finding out, that you want to hear more about? You don't know what you want? Yes.
You talk about auto-marking frameworks, is there an automatic generation system?
Okay. Anything else? encode this, these two topics, everyone here will be happy, basically. Okay. Challenge accepted. Actually, automobile frameworks, we're going to talk about it here yet. There's a lot we have to know about before. So I'm assuming that by the last questions, most people here feel like they don't know enough to even ask a question. So I'm going to start with the idea of what's the difference between block objects, stubs, fakes, shims, etc., etc., etc. I'll just tell you that bugger when the time is right. And that's where we produce this example, a new interface. And the new interface in the system allows me to replace an object with something that looks like. And also I change the signature logging manager in the constructor to use an iLog interface. Now, this idea of injecting the dependency through the constructor is called constructor injection. There are several types of injection, block injection, etc. Constructor injection is used the most. But anybody know why? Guarantees that you have to set them. It's not optional. When you have these parameters, it's not optional. So if you, in terms of design, when I look at a constructor and I look at the list of parameters, I can see all the dependencies that I need to make the object function. So it makes things even more readable. And also, if I have properties that I need to set, I have to remember that. Okay, so what else do I do after I create the interface? I have to create something that implements the interface. And I'm not using a framework yet. You have to understand how they work. So in this case, I'll create a new class in my code called the fake log. Notice it's not called the mock or stuff, not called the shim. It's called the fake log. I'll explain why it's called the fake and not the other things after a few minutes. But this class exists in my production code. Sorry, it's just in my test code. It does not exist in my production code. The interface exists in my production code. So my production code sees the interface, but it doesn't know that there is even such a thing as a fake log. In my test, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create an instance of fake log, send it into a new logging manager, call this login OK, and then check that the interface method that I say write was called with the right string. How do I check it? Because this class is in my test, it's fully under my control, I can change its code. So I can just override the method for write and save the value and put it in a public variable. I can assert it. In this case, I'm using the fake logger, sending it in, and I'm asserting it next time. I'm using it to verify if my test is passed. When something that looks like something else is used to verify that your test is passed, if you assert against it, it's called a mock object. So when we have a fake object, based on how you use it, it could be a mock object. Fake is anything that looks like something.